हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज डॉक्टर अशोक कुमार फ्रॉम गवर्नमेंट वुमेन इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज अजमेर। दिस इज लेक्चर 4 ऑफ लीनियर वायर एंटीना सीरीज एंड इन दिस लेक्चर 4 वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट क्वार्टर वेवलेंथ मोनोपोल एंटीना। द फॉलोइंग कंटेंट विल बी एड्रेस ड्यूरिंग दिस लेक्चर 4। इनिशियली द इंट्रोडक्शन, देन डिस्कस अबाउट द इमेज थ्योरी that can be used in the designing of microstrip antenna for calculating the radiated field, then radiated field by a quarter wavelength monopole antenna, calculation of radiation resistance and directivity of quarter wavelength monopole antenna, why top loading is used in monopole antenna and what are the effect of imperfect ground plane on monopole antenna, I mean quarter wavelength monopole antenna. The following reference books are considered to develop the contents of this lecture 4 of wire antenna series. Introduction. As we have discussed that dipole antennas for high frequency and very high frequency application tends to the several meter long, because the frequency of high frequency and very high frequency having in terms of kilohertz and in terms of megahertz, then when we are calculating the wavelength or we can say it's a length, that we are getting length in terms of several meters. So constructing a dipole to radiate vertically polarized electric field orientation is perpendicular to the surface of the earth. Electromagnetic waves poses some real challenges due to the size of the antenna and the presence of the earth itself. So by using image theory, the fields due to a vertical electrical current element kept along on a infinitely large perfect electric conductor, also known as the ground plane, are the same as the field radiated by the elements and its image without the ground plane. So this is the basic principle of image theory, and this basic principle we have discussed in subsequent slide also. Therefore it is possible for vertically create a half wave dipole by placing a quarter wavelength long wire called a monopole vertically above an infinite large ground plane. The image theory can be understood by considering the figure of 13, and its theory state that if there is a current A, B and C above an infinite, this is the infinite ground plane having the conductivity sigma equal to infinite, perfect conducting ground plane, this is the perfect conducting ground plane, the ground will act as a mirror to generate its image. As you can see here, this is the equivalent of image theory. A dash, B dash and C dash, as you can see in this figure, A and B are the two currents, A and B are the two currents, and any other case such as C may be viewed as the combination of these two. As you can see, this is A and this is B, and the resultant we can calculate the current C. So the field at any point above the ground plane, as we have calculated the field above the ground plane, is equivalent to the field generated by the current sources A, B or C and its image A dash, B dash and C dash without the presence of the ground plane. Here you can see one important thing is that this is the perfect conducting ground plane, and this is the direction of the current A. We have to represent some books, they are representing its I above the ground plane, suppose D is the distance, so we can also analyze according to them. But here we have considered the current element A and its image current is in opposite direction, as you can see. But vertically polarized antenna having the current B and its image current is also along the direction of B, and this is the resultant current, and you can see here the current image is just reverse, as you can see here. So we can say for the vertically polarized antenna the current is additive, and in this case we have to analyze the monopole antennas. So the image current is one of the same amplitude as the original source, and its direction is determined by the boundary condition, such as Z stating that the tangential electric field ET must be zero at the boundaries. Here you can see the tangential electrical field is zero at the boundary. So vertical field is only exist in when we are considering the image theory. So using the image theory, we can remove the ground plane and treat the problem as if it were in a space but had a pair of current sources, as you can see this and this current sources we have considered. So applying the image theory to the monopole antennas, we can see that it is equivalent to the case of B B dash. This is B current and this is the B dash current, as you can see in this figure 13, which is a half wavelength dipole in free space. So further, we have calculated the radiated field by a monopole antenna. As you can see, this is a vertically polarized, as we have stated in the first slide also of this lecture, and it's behave like a half wavelength dipole antenna. Considering a monopole of length L by 2, fed its base and kept above the ground plane. As you can see, this is a geometry of the monopole above, and this is infinite ground plane, we can say perfect electric conductor. And we are putting this monopole antenna along the direction of Z, and this is the length from the origin. This is the origin point, and this is the total length L by 2, and it is oriented along the Z axis. And we are providing the feed at one end, which is put it at the origin. By image theory, this structure is equivalent to a dipole of length L radiating into the free space. As you can see here, this is the origin where we are providing the feed, and this is the length of L by 2, and this is the length of minus L by 2 to 0. So this structure behave like a dipole antenna having the total length L, and diameter we have considered twice of A, and we can say it's the radius of the wire is A, and which is taking the assumption A is very less than lambda, and we can take a observation point P in a space, and there we have to calculate the radiated field by the monopole antenna. So the electric and magnetic field in a far field region are given by equation 59 and equation 60, as we have discussed in lecture 3 for a finite length dipole antenna, and there we have calculated the electric and magnetic field equation by a standard design procedure or standard design consideration in a lecture 3 when we are going to discuss about the finite length dipole. So we are considering these equations. These are the two equations where we have calculated the E field in the direction of theta and H field along the phi component, or we can say unit vector A theta and A phi component. So again, we can say in a monopole antenna, the transverse electromagnetic waves will be exist. So considering the case of monopole as a quarter wavelength long, so we are considering length L is equal to lambda by 2. The field expression, this field expression equation 59 and equation 60 can be reduced to equation 81 and 82 in the form of magnetic field as well as electric field. And this is the expression for electric and magnetic field for a monopole antenna. So here you can see this electric and magnetic field is identical to the field radiated by a half wavelength monopole antenna also, half wavelength dipole antenna also. So this original problem has an infinitely large ground plane and there are no fields below the ground plane. This is the assumption we are taking in the case of monopole antenna. Further, in equation 81 and 82, when we are evaluating only in the upper hemisphere for 0 to pi by 2 and phi is equal to 2 pi. So we are considering the limit phi is equal to 0 to pi and theta is equal to 0 to pi. So the important difference in monopole and dipole antenna is here, that when we have to integrate the dipole antenna along 0 to pi, but here in the case of monopole antenna we have to integrate this E field and H field along the 0 to pi by 2 for the theta values. This is only the difference, and by considering these two analyses we have to calculate the radiated power for calculating the radiation resistance as well as the directivity. So the total radiated power is obtained by integrating the radiation intensity over the upper hemisphere and substituting the radiation intensity u theta and phi from equation 3. We get, this is the equation 3 that we have discussed in lecture 3 of wire antenna series, and this is the general or standard calculation for calculating the radiated power, which is equal to phi is equal to 0 to 2 pi and theta is equal to 0 to pi. So this is the difference. Here you can see in the dipole antenna we are taking theta is equal to 0 to pi, we have to integrate, but here we have to integrate theta is equal to 0 to pi by 2, and similar procedure we can adopt it. And we have considering the value of E and U theta comma phi from the equation 73, then we can get the radiated power, which is the function of theta, as you can see in equation 83. On performing the integration of theta, the total radiated power, and the total radiated power we can calculate by using the analytical solution also, and we are not discussing here the analytical solution. So we are considering the same assumption as we have considered in the case of dipole antenna. So we can calculate the total radiated power, which is equal to P radiated is equal to 1 by 2 I naught ka square into 36.54. So here you can see the total radiated power, P radiated is equal to 1 by 2 multiplication of the total radiated power, the half wavelength dipole antenna, when we are considering KL by 2 is equal to pi by 2. So radiation resistance is computed by equating the average radiated power to the power dissipated in an equivalent resistance carrying the same input current, as this analysis we have also considered in the case of infinitesimal dipole, in the case of a small dipole, in the case of finite length dipole, I mean half wavelength dipole also. So we can calculate the radiated power, which is equal to 1 by 2 I naught square 36.54. This is the calculated value from the, by considering the electric and magnetic field for a monopole antenna, which is equal to 1 by 2 I naught square R radiated, and this is the power dissipated in an equivalent resistance carrying the same input current. So we can calculate the radiation resistance equal to 36.54 ohm. So this is the important analysis that we are get from this calculation, and we can see the radiation resistance of the monopole equal to 36.54. And if you have to compare this radiation resistance with the dipole antenna, in that case it, the radiation resistance of the monopole is just half the radiation resistance of the dipole antenna. Further, we have to calculate the directivity. For calculating the directivity, first need to calculate the maximum direct radiation intensity, and maximum radiation intensity occur at theta is equal to pi by 2, and this can be calculated by using the equation 73. So we can calculate the u max equal to neta by 2 I naught upon 2 pi ka square by using this expression 87, and this can be calculated by considering the value of u theta comma phi from the equation 73, which is equal to neta by 2 I naught upon 2 pi ka square cos square pi by 2 cos theta upon sine square theta. So this is the radiation intensity, and by putting the value of theta is equal to pi by 2, then we are getting neta by 2 I naught upon 2 pi ka magnitude square. So here we are getting u max. So maximum directivity d, or we can also represent d naught, is calculated by dividing u max, this u max, by the average radiation intensity, and average radiation intensity equal to P radiated upon per unit solid angle, which is equal to 4 pi. So when we are dividing this value in the form of maximum directivity d naught, which is equal to 4 pi u max upon P radiated, which is equal to 3.284. So we can say the directivity of the monopole antenna is twice the directivity of the dipole antenna radiating in a free space. So this is another important conclusion that we are get from this analysis in the case of monopole antenna. So the maximum directivity occurs along the ground plane and the radiation is vertically polarized, as we have taken assumption initially that the monopole antennas are vertically polarized. In that case, we can find out the electric and magnetic field equation by using the image theory principle. Further, we can calculate the directivity in terms of decibel at the maximum value of directivity of cos theta is equal to pi by 2, which is equal to 3.284, as you can see here in equation 88. So we can calculate directivity in terms of dB is equal to 51164 dB. So the directivity is high as compared to the infinitesimal small dipole as well as the half wavelength dipole. In that case, we are getting directivity less than the directivity of the monopole antenna. So directivity is high as compared to other wire antennas. So the corresponding maximum effective area we can also calculate it, and this is the maximum effective area is equal to lambda square upon 4 pi d naught. This is the standard expression that we have considered from the antenna theory, which is equal to lambda square upon 4 pi, and we are putting the value of d naught is equal to 3.284. in that case, we are getting the maximum effective area, which is equal to 0.26 lambda square. So this is another important expression in the case of monopole antenna. If we have considered the imaginary component or reactance part for calculating the impedance, input impedance of the dipole, it is a function of the length L equal to lambda by 4, which is having the value of just half the value of the dipole antenna, which is equal to J21.25. Thus, the total input impedance for L equal to lambda by 4 is equal to Zn equal to 36.54 plus J21.25. So this is the input impedance when we are considering the reactance part also. Otherwise, then we have considering the only radiation resistance. In that case, we are considering the value of 36.54. And one more impedance, the wave impedance, we can also calculate it in the monopole antenna also, as we have calculated in the previous three lectures of this wire antenna series. In that case, the wave impedance ZW equal to E theta upon S phi, which is nearly equal to the neta, and neta is equal to 125 or 377 ohm for a free space. So the wave impedance is same as we have calculated previously, because the monopole antenna is also radiating the transverse electromagnetic waves in a free space. And this is the radiation pattern for a lambda by 2 dipole. And this radiation pattern we have considered above an infinite perfect ground plane. So in that case, we are considering the upper hemisphere also. And here you can see the radiation pattern of the monopole antenna, and we have eliminated the lower hemisphere due to the presence of the infinite perfect conducting ground plane. So this is the radiation pattern for a monopole antenna. And in a summary form, we can summarize the advantages of the monopole antenna. So the monopole antenna is very popular antenna due to their certain advantages, such as the size is half of the corresponding dipoles. Dipole may be the half wavelength dipole, may be the void type dipole, may be biconical dipole, any form of the dipoles. The size is half of the corresponding dipole. Second important, the directivity doubles that of its corresponding dipoles. Corresponding dipoles may be in this form. The input impedance is just half of its corresponding dipole, maybe the biconical void type or lambda by 2 dipole, etc. And fourth point, the corresponding wavelength of the quarter wavelength monopole is a resonant antenna, as similar to the half wavelength dipole antenna. So input impedance is about 36.54 ohm, which matches well with the 50 ohm standard transmission line, as we are using this is the 50 ohm standard transmission line for the practical application. So, and the ratio of VSWR is equal to 1.35, less than, and which is less than equal to 2. So we can say the monopole antenna is very, very important when we are using in the case of radio broadcasting towers to mobile phone, very low frequency applications and very low frequency between 30 to 300 kilohertz and 3 to 30 kilohertz we can use in the communication system. The best example you can see in the vehicular communication, there we are using the monopole antenna because the antenna having the impedance just near to the 50 ohm transmission line. But in the case of dipole antenna, the impedance is about 73 ohm, which is equal to nearly equal to the 75 ohm standard transmission line. So these are some important advantages of the monopole antennas. Further, the important thing came in the monopole antenna, that is top loading, and why the top loading is considered or used in a monopole antenna. So in this figure 16 you can see a top loaded short monopole antenna, typically for very low frequency and low frequency communication system. And here you can see this is the support insulator and these are the flat top wires, insulator and support wires. And here you can see this is grounded and this is the feed wire, or we can say it's a vertical radiator. So this is the configuration of the top loading. And what is the impact of top loading? So by using top loading, we can improve the feed point resistance, and we have represented feed point resistance RA, because the top set to the wire act as a capacitance to ground rather than the open end of the antenna. So the current at the top of the antenna no longer need to go to zero. I mean current I is not equal to zero. So in this case, the current at the top having the maximum, as you can see in lecture 3 of the current distribution for the L is equal to lambda by 4 dipole. So in that case, the current is not equal to zero, but in the open-ended waveguide solution or open-ended waveguide antennas, the current is zero as the height. Suppose this is the height h, which is equal to zero. In that case, the current is equal to zero, but in the case of monopole antenna, the current at the top is not equal to zero. So this is the second important thing. Third important is that to improve radiation efficiency due to the support of substantial RF current at upper region of the antenna. So this is the third important characteristics through which we can enhance or improve the radiation efficiency due to the supporting of the RF current, because the I is not equal to at the top of the monopole antenna, or we can say it at the end of the monopole antenna. So we are using top loading in a monopole antenna. And if you go through the detail more analysis about, you can consider these reference books as given in below. And one more effect that we have considered in the case of monopole antenna, that is the effect of imperfect ground plane on monopole antenna. The performance of monopole antenna is degraded if the ground plane is resistive, curved or finite in size. So by using these three phenomena, the performance of the monopole antenna is degraded. So we can understand this effect of the finite conductivity of the ground plane. It means the ground plane size is small in as compared to infinite ground plane. And it is the important in large scale applications such as AM broadcasting, where the ground plane is created by burying individual wires in the ground in a radial, I mean real spokes pattern around the antenna. In this case, the power density at the surface of the earth diminishes more rapidly than the square of the radius R from the antenna. As this we have to discuss in the case of a finite length dipole or infinitesimal dipole. In that case, we have analyzed this effect power density and effectively partially absorbing rather than ideally reflecting the radiated power. So I mean, or we can say that due to the presence of finite ground plane, the wave is absorbed by the earth, or we can say by the ground plane, irrespective of reflecting the radiated power from the ground plane, as we have discussed in the case of monopole antenna. So this finite conductivity of a ground plane is impacted the characteristics of the antenna also. When the antennas are used for transmission, I mean transmission application in excess of about 1000 miles, the curvature of the surface of the earth also reduces the radiated power. So this is another impact on the of the ground plane on a monopole antenna. So the radiated power it reduces, and when the radiated power is reduces, in that case the directivity and other parameter gain is also reduces. And the finite ground plane is a fairly significant effect on both the feed point impedance and radiation pattern, I mean gain or directivity, due to the creation of the backlog. So overall we can say that the imperfect ground plane is impacted the characteristics of the monopole antenna, especially in the far field characteristics, in which we are considering the radiated power and gain or directivity due to the creation of the back lobe or side lobes, because the complete signal is not reflected, the finite ground plane is not completely reflected the radiated power, and it is partially absorbed by the ground plane. So this is the impact of imperfect ground plane on a monopole antenna, and this is very very important in the case of monopole antenna. So in this lecture we have discussed about first the introduction, then image theory, and further we have calculated the electric and magnetic field by using image theory for the monopole antenna, and then further we have calculated the radiation resistance and directivity for a monopole antenna when we are considering it's a quarter wavelength long, and then finally the advantages and why we are using top loading in the case of monopole antenna, and in the last what is the effect of ground plane on the characteristics of the radiation antenna, that we have discussed in this lecture 4 of wire antenna series. Thank you very much everyone for watching this lecture. I hope this lecture is beneficial for you. In the next lecture we are going to discuss about some kind of curved wire antenna, in which we are going to discuss about the loop antenna, and subsequent lecture we are going to discuss about some kind of wire antenna that are being used in a mobile communication systems. Thank you.